why is this extreme engineering? We are trying to push the boundaries in terms of a few different things here. One is, of course, this whole dimension of converting waste streams into very high value products, biofuels, biodiesel, not just putting more money, energy, resources into waste streams and getting just clean water. We are getting so much more, and we are using microorganisms to do this work for us.
All right, Kartik, so this, to me, almost looks like you're boiling macaroni. What do we got here?
So these are the organisms which are actually converting the urine or wastewater streams into nitrogen gas. We are basically engineering the community rather than engineering a given organism. And if you look really close, you can see the nitrogen bubbles which are on the
bubbles,
inside.
I see bubbles,
yeah. And so that's the nitrogen.
That's what it's producing.
Most of what we breathe is nitrogen.
Absolutely.
Anyway. So it's cleaning the water, adding nitrogen to the air, which is harmless.
With much less energy, 60% less energy, and a lot less CO2. Imagine embedding water factories, energy factories, resource factories into existing or new developments where people are living, getting clean water, getting energy, but not from a centralized model.
What's this primary sludge I've been hearing about? What is that stuff?
It's concentrated sewage.
Oh, yeah, okay. So let's just say, I understand you look at this stuff and you see an opportunity there.
Yes, absolutely.
Whereas someone like me would look at it and say, get it away from me. You see it as a resource.
What Irene is doing is she's blending the sewage sludge along with the food waste, because this is something that municipalities all over the world are interested in doing. The whole mindset is changing. It's not wastewater treatment plant anymore. These are resource recovery facilities, energy recovery facilities, and this is where people are going. What we are producing here are liquid phase chemicals that we can convert into bioplastics. We can convert into end products like biodiesel, biofuels. So that's what we want to do. We want to harvest the liquid chemicals, because that gives us a much more flexibility rather than just being stuck with one end product, biogas. We are looking for high value end products, chemicals, fuels, and so on. But you see, what we are doing is we are disrupting the link between food crop and biodiesel. So far, we've been growing these food crops to make biodiesel. We don't have to do that anymore. We can make biodiesel from sewage sludge,
and
food waste.
Food crop for something else.
For food.
Smells like gas. So but it's nicer than gas, though.
Yes,
it's not like fuel. It smells different than normal fuel.
So we can take just about any feedstock, fecal sludge, sewage sludge, food waste, make lipids, go to biodiesel. And for this, we are not using bacteria, we are using a yeast culture. And Shashwat has just recently sequenced the genome. Once we understand what the organism can do in terms of its genetic makeup, we can try and see how we can squeeze this based on engineering.
This is our instrument called a Kaya Cube, and we use this for automatic extraction of either DNA or RNA from our samples.
So all the reactors you saw, and we get samples from all around the world, and this is where we open everything up. The mRNA will give us information in terms of what these cells are capable of doing or what they're actually doing.
So DNA is what they are. RNA is what it does.
This is the next generation of environmental engineering. It's not just about traditional disciplines. This is really changing the conversation. This is really changing the language that environmental engineers can speak. What comes out of this process is really the new generation of environmental scientists and engineers.
Cool. Right here at Columbia.
Right here at Columbia.